Hey, good evening, everybody. My name is Sandra Thavada. I'm the Director of Guidance and Counseling, and I'd like to welcome you all this evening. You will be hearing an extremely important presentation from Agent Andrew Hurd. Agent Hurd is a special agent with Homeland Security Investigation and is a member of the Rio Grande Valley Child Exploitation Task Force. He is with us tonight to present on a topic that applies to all of us, but is of more concern with every smartphone, tablet, computer, and gaming system our children access online. Please join me in welcoming Special Agent Andrew Hurd.
I will. Good evening. How are you all? I'll go ahead and let you know this is an interactive session. I'll be providing information, but also I'll be asking you questions. So, you know, feel free to interact. If anybody has anything to add, any questions or anything else, please feel free to ask questions. Also tonight we have Special Agent John Renosa, who's on the task force. He'll be chiming in with a few things as well. But thank you so much for coming out tonight, for taking time out of your evening, for investing in yourselves, your children, your community, and I can't thank you enough for that. My name is Special Agent Andrew Hurd, and I'm with Homeland Security Investigations. Have you all ever heard of Homeland Security Investigations before? Yes, we're the criminal investigators for all 22 agencies of Homeland Security. I'm also part of something called the Rio Grande Valley Child Exploitation Investigations Task Force. That task force was created about 3 years ago by our group supervisor, Eddie Hurtado. And what the task force consists of is a collaboration between our federal, state, and local partners. On the task force, we have almost every federal, state, and local agency represented, including to include our AUSAs, our district attorneys for all of the counties, state partners. Some of our newer partners include CPS, DPS, polygraphers. And it is a combined effort that we all come together for one reason and one reason only, and that's to keep our kids safe. Project iGuardian was instituted by Homeland Security Investigations, and that's really our cornerstone for anything that's related to the possession, receipt, distribution, transportation, or production of child pornography. That is our cornerstone that we work our investigations from, and has been instituted here in the Rio Grande Valley. Here's a little sample of how our investigations work. Normally we'll receive a tip either from the National Center for Missing and Exploited Children, from parents, from other law enforcement partners, from our district attorneys or United States attorneys. From those tips, we'll do investigations and we will build a case. We'll eventually get to the point where we'll conduct a search warrant or a knock and talk, or an arrest warrant. With that, we will go to a place, to a residence, a business, or any entity, and we're normally looking for what you see on the top there, and that is electronic devices. Anything that's capable of connecting to the internet, storing data, storing information, that is able to communicate even sometimes from device to device to share that material. iGuardian. Around 2011, Homeland Security had said, we've been working transnational criminal organizations and counterterrorism since 2001, since we were created. They also heavily invested into our child exploitation program, but in 2011, the agency said, what if we put a program in place that could get ahead of the curve a little bit, where we could inform the public, inform our partners, and create a bond or a partnership with the community to teach them how to be safe online, to teach them about evolving technology interests, threats, and how to really keep themselves and particularly the kids safe in doing so. So Project iGuardian is a partnership between the National Center for Missing and Exploited Children, Homeland Security Investigations, and our ICAC task forces, the Internet Crimes Against Children task forces. Internet safety. When I talk about internet safety tonight, and going forward, I really am talking about a partnership between all of us, between the parents, the guardians, the communities, and law enforcement. So after you receive this presentation tonight, you'll be armed with the knowledge of how to stay safe online, how to institute anti-cyberbullying, you know, and the like. And that point forward, we're kind of partners working together between us and the school districts and our other law enforcement partners to not only keep ourselves safe, but our children and our community safe as well. So I'll ask you all, what do we do online? Don't be shy. I said this was going to be an interactive.
Social media.
Social media. What else?
Shop,
games. What else?
Email.
Messaging. Would it be safe to say that we pretty much do everything online?
Yes.
In the audience, who has a social media account? Look around. Almost everybody. Who has a phone? Tablet? Computer? Gaming system in their house? Who has more than one social media account, whether it be Facebook, Snapchat, Instagram, Twitter, any of that? Look around. Everybody, right? When I give this presentation to the kids in schools, I often say, who has a Facebook account? Well, I was recently informed that Facebook, you know, is not as popular as it once was. I'm sorry, what was it? Okay.
He doesn't have one.
Okay. But I was told it wasn't popular. People have it, but they really use it to connect and everything else, and it's been described as for the older generation.
Yes.
Well, I fall into that. So that being said, there are other things like Snapchat and Instagram that are the cornerstones of social media today. And people will still have a Facebook account because they'll use Facebook Messenger just for the convenience to be able to communicate and add friends and then filter out to other social media platforms. So, who has ever accepted a friend request from somebody that you haven't met in person? Anybody? But you see that maybe they're a friend of a friend? I have before. And it's amazing the number of people who have, because if you sit there and say, well, they're friends with John, they've got to be a great person, right? So let's go ahead and accept them. No. The reason why is because when you accept a friend request on Facebook or you allow someone to follow you on Instagram that you don't know, what you're basically doing is inviting that person to your front door, opening the door and saying, come on in and join the family. Why? Because what do we put on social media? Literally everything. Think about it. We just came out of the holiday season. Who took pictures with their friends and their family during the holiday season? And what do we do on top of that? We tag them, right? We tag our friends. So you give someone access to your social media site, they basically can create a hierarchy of who you are, who you're friends with, who your family is, look through your friends list if you don't have it properly secured or shut down, and be able to send friend requests to all of them. I went to a high school. In that high school, I asked, who has the most friends? This kid said he had thousands of friends. Thousands. I had him open his phone real quick, and he showed me. And sure enough, he did. And I said, do you know every single person in that friends list? He said, no. He was honest and said that. But here's the thing. Not only your friends, but your family members. And I always tell the kids when I go out to the schools, you may know every single thing that I'm going to tell you in this presentation, but does everybody in your social media friends list know the same thing? Are you able to protect your brothers and sisters and nieces and nephews and friends of friends, children and nieces and nephews and everything else? Because what we're talking about is online safety. And we're going to talk about the difference between predators and pedophiles. And a predator is somebody who is on the hunt, and they will go through. And if they send a friend request to all thousands of people that were in that high schooler's friends list, how many accepted friend requests does it take to be successful for a predator or a pedophile to get a target? One. Just that one. And we're going to talk about how that happens.
I saw the part of you that only when you're older you
see too. You will see too. I held a pack of cards, but every stroke of luck has gotta bleed through. It's gotta bleed through. You held the balance of the time that only blindly I could read you. But I could read you. It's like you told me, go forward slowly. It's not a race to the end. Well, you look like yourself, but you're somebody else. Only it ain't on the surface. Well, you talk like yourself. No, I hear someone else. And now you're making me nervous. Better part of every bit of beating heart that I had, whatever I had. I finally sat alone, pitch black, flesh and bone. Couldn't believe that you were gone. Well, you look like yourself, but you're somebody else. Only it ain't on the surface. Well, you talk like yourself.
Talk about it in just a second.
I saw the part of you that only when you're older you'll see too. You will see too.
What do you think? You can be anybody that you want online, right? Just because you have a username or a profile picture, does that mean that's who that person is? No. How easy is it to create a profile and a username, go out to the internet, get a photo, and you can be anybody that you want? John? This is Special Agent John Renosa. I'm going to have him talk about just how easy that is to be anybody that you want online.
So as part of the Homeland Security Investigations, the Rio Grande Valley Child Exploitation Task Force, we do undercover investigations. I can post an ad online, and within minutes, I'm going to get 4, 5, 6, 7 responses. And within 24 hours, we're getting people to try to meet us to engage in, you know, illicit activities. With a, you know, even when I pretend I'm a 13-year-old female or male.
They may want to
sure.
Use the microphone.
So when we. So one of our investigative techniques is going online and going undercover to look for some of these predators. Particularly, we've had cases where we can post online pretending to be a 13, 14, 12-year-old male, female. And within minutes, we're getting, you know, multiple adults responding to the ads. And within 24 hours, it can rapidly progress from conversations to meeting to engage in illicit activities. You know, I don't want to get too graphic, but some of these adults are already setting up, you know, sexual activity. So it can escalate very quickly.
Thank you, John. As part of the iGuardian presentations, we have age-appropriate presentations that we provide to the tweens, to the high school level, And then what you all are receiving tonight is the parent, staff, and administrator presentation. So when we go to the schools, this presentation right here will be tailored really towards the grade level that we're talking to, and talk about certain aspects of what they do online to try to convey that message to it. Anytime that we go online, there's inherent risk. There's a risk of cyberbullying, exposure to inappropriate content, online predators, and up to and including sexting. This is what our list used to look like. We used to have presentations set up for the elementary, the middle, the high school, and the parent, staff, and teacher presentation. What we saw was a shift in the last few years, though, from the high school presentations that we were given, the topics that we were covering, have now gone down, or shall I say traveled down, to even the elementary school level. We've been called in to certain school districts where fourth and fifth graders are sexting, and we are having to intervene with those school districts and with the parents, because fourth and fifth graders have tablets and phones and are sharing what the legal term is, nude pics, and trading them and trying to impress who they are currently dating, or somebody who is requesting them, or in some cases they are even blackmailed to send them. Myths about predators. The myths are that they're old men, they're pedophiles, pretend to be younger, and abduct kids from homes. All of us grew up during the age of John Walsh, you know, and Stranger Danger, and in campaign ads like that. We used to think that kids were safe when they were in our homes because they were under the purview of our families and our parents and everything else. Well, now they have tablets and devices in their hands where they can be safe in their room but have access to the world. And more importantly, the world can have access to them as well. Because you can go anywhere you want on the internet, communicate to anybody that you want, and the only thing that's going to stop you is parents being involved and putting those safety settings on some of those devices, or getting involved and knowing usernames and passwords of all of the apps that are on there, and overlooking some of the friends list of the social media sites. The truth is they're mostly men about 26 years old. We've seen them as young as 17, 18. We've seen them as old as in their 70s. Generally not pedophiles, rarely lie about their age, and usually do not abduct. Why do you think they don't abduct? Exactly, they don't have to. Because generally they're not pedophiles. So anybody know what the definition of a pedophile is? The difference between a predator and a pedophile is a predator is all about control. It's all in the name. They prey on a target, and they are there for the controlling. A pedophile is somebody who is psychologically diagnosed to prefer a younger gender, and that is what, you know, is their sexual preference, is what interests them, or anything else. What we mostly encounter online is predators, though. It's all about control to them. So who are the victims? Usually about 13 to 15 years old. I would say that has changed to maybe 11 to 16 years old. Mostly girls, but boys are sometimes targets. Historically, there may be a history of sexual abuse or risky behavior in the child's past, in the family. There may be something that causes them to reach out to look for acceptance, either on the internet, from somebody that they encounter on social media, or they may just feel that that's how that they can communicate. Here is Julie's story to show just how easily that can happen.
The internet, it's a tool that has to be used properly. You know, it's like a knife. I mean, it's very helpful, but it can also cut you. My name is Julie, When I was 13, I started talking to Tom. He didn't act or even sound like a 56-year-old man. So he was different on the computer. I knew that I wasn't supposed to be talking to him, but I did it out of a retaliation against my parents. It felt nice to have somebody who wasn't always trying to tell you what to do. It started to get more like a relationship where it went from just friends to best friends, more personal relationship than best friends. I would instant message him between 3 and 6 hours a day. I was really upset whenever I couldn't get on the internet because I knew that he would be like, "What were you doing?" And he emailed me like 10 times wondering where I was at. Then you feel like extremely bad about it. It was an opportunity for him to manipulate more. I trusted him more than anybody else. He mentioned, "Wouldn't it be nice if we were together all the time?" And then the thought came up of running away. The night I left, I kissed all my brothers goodnight, and he was in his truck, and we just rode out. I ran away for 3 weeks. The day that I was found, we were on our way to Reno. Somebody reported us and saw our truck. I knew pretty much it's over. And I mean, I never really thought the day would come. He's going to be in jail for 25 years. He sent a letter to me saying that it was my fault and that he was going to kill me if he ever got out of jail. I was really upset because he didn't say anything about caring about me. I didn't think of his background and I didn't apply it to myself, and so maybe he could have done anything to me, even killed me. And so, you know, now that I'm back, I feel like there's this huge emptiness inside of me. If I could have talked to people, maybe I would have had a different view on some things. If you're planning to run away, it doesn't help solve anything. If it does anything, it makes it worse. Little things can end up becoming a big thing. I kind of wish that I never would have run away in the first place. I would never do it again.
That is Julie's story. When I go out to the schools, I ask, could that happen to anybody at any school who's searching for acceptance, who's not, doesn't have someone that they can talk to, who doesn't bring a problem up to a trusted adult, teacher, administrator, counselor? When I give this presentation to the school counselors, I have them pay attention to that, because I often wonder how many Julies are out there in every school that we don't know about, that might be one friend request, that might be one friend that they make on the internet that they can't talk, that they feel that that's the only person that they can talk to, and it goes unreported. How many of those are out there? Grooming. Who's heard the term grooming before? Anybody? Yes. What is grooming?
When an adult starts, I've seen it personally, an adult starts befriending the child and there's a bug. Let's go see this bug. Okay, and then they entice the child away from the parents. And if the parents aren't aware, they trust the person even though it's a family member. And he'll take that child away thinking that the parents are not gonna be they're gonna be oblivious of the whole situation, so that he can groom them to get their trust. And then he can pounce on them and do things to them behind the parents' back.
And what you're talking about is grooming towards an opportunity or...
Yes, that's one, but this is internet. It's similar.
One of the things I asked the kids when I go out to the schools, I said, you know, who would want the brand new Apple XR if I was giving it away for free? Who would want it? Even in the audience, we have hands. But here's the deal. I'm going to tell you the conditions up front, and we'll see if you still want it afterwards. If you want the new iPhone XR, over $1,000 phone, right? I'll send it to you. You can have it next week. I'll FedEx it to you. You can receive it. It'll have a data plan to it. But in when you receive that, I want you to talk to me through the apps that are on there. I want you to forget your friends and your family. I want you to lie to them and make excuses as to why you can't go to this family occasion or to this birthday party, or you can't hang out with them, because all I want you to do is pay attention to me, because I'm the one who gave you this device. Slowly and slowly, I'm going to take your life away from you that you know and shape it into what I want it to be, where you are more and more dependent upon me. Now, if that was the case, who would still want the phone? Nobody, right? Well, I do that as a courtesy to paint that picture, to say, a predator, do they tell you what the terms and the conditions are up front? Here I gave you the opportunity to opt out of that. When somebody does it with a motive behind it, they're not going to let you know what that motive is, and you're not going to understand it until it is too late. So that is grooming. So we look for signs of grooming like that. Receiving gifts that are out of the ordinary, receiving opportunities or gifts that you can't be explained, that seem too good to be true. That is grooming. So what can you do? You can talk to your children about relationships. You can set a policy of meeting offline. We never meet offline, right? Absolutely not. Know your child's friends online. This is where I challenge the parents. Be a little nosy. Be involved online. And I usually get some evil looks from the kids when I say that. But that being said, I make a deal, okay? I'm not going to throw you under the bus completely. I challenge the parents, be online. See what your kids are doing online. Occasionally sign into their accounts. They should not have a social media platform that you do not have the username and password to and can usually and occasionally sign in and just see what's happening. So, what's the deal? Not throwing the kids under the bus. I challenge the parents. When you do that, occasionally look there, but don't get down into the weeds. You know, if it's adult appropriate behavior where they're bantering with their friends, where they're just kidding back and forth, don't hold them accountable to that. You're looking at an elevated level as to what seems out of the ordinary. What is it something I need to pay more attention to? Do you have this friend that I don't know, that our family doesn't know? How do you know them? Have you ever met them in real life? You need to delete them. That is the behavior that I'm talking about, that parents need to be more involved. Teach your children about the warning signs. And if you see any of those, call the police. Notify the school. Get people involved who can help with the situation. Revealing too much. What's okay? Most pictures are okay that we put on social media. Why? Because they fit what is appropriate for our families. Some families, you know, will choose to include special occasions, trips to the beach, vacations. It's really up to the adults in the family as to what's appropriate. So one family may look at another family's social media content and say, I would never do that. But that's okay because that's what's acceptable in their family. What's not okay is certain kinds of personal information or inappropriate information. And this is, if you're putting revealing photos out there, that might be something that catches other people's attention. Personal information. Hopefully on our social media sites, not anymore. When they were first created, they asked for like your address and your phone number and all of this. Hopefully we don't have any of that on there. Why? Because there are paid for sites out there that if you plug that information into, you can find a lot about people. Have y'all seen those and have heard of those and everything else? So don't make people's jobs easier as far as trying to find out information about you. So Some of those are usernames, passwords, school, physical address. Think about this. If you don't know who's in your social media friends list, and you have pictures of your kids in there, and they're in their baseball uniforms, and school t-shirts, and school uniforms, and everything else, have you just told anybody who has ill intent where your kids go? If you have your traditional pictures where you stand on the front porch, what might be right behind you? Your address, or in front of your house? What might be in the street or in the driveway? Your car? You might make it easier than you think for people to try to figure out more about your life if you don't know who you're dealing with. Passwords. Do not ever share your passwords. This is what can happen.
I used to have a best friend named Katie. We shared everything, even our passwords. One day I got online and noticed a bunch of emails from someone whose name I didn't recognize. The subject was, "You look hot." I opened one up and read what it said. It was from a guy at school who was 2 grades older than me. He said he wanted to do stuff that I'm embarrassed to even say. These girls at school, the beautiful people as I call them, they convinced Katie to give them my password. She thought that if she gave it to them, it would make them like her. I think she was scared too. These girls do mean things to everyone. Anyway, the girls got into my email and sent emails to all the senior guys that looked like they were from me. In the email was a picture of me with no clothes on. They got a picture of someone else from an adult website and photoshopped my class picture headshot on it, I guess. Then they wrote things like, "I will do anything to make your fantasies come true," and signed my name. Since it came from my account, everyone thought I really sent it. Now I can't go anywhere at school without guys looking at me funny and people whispering and pointing at me when they think I can't see. I don't have any friends, and I don't even talk to Katie anymore. I feel so alone. I wish I could move somewhere and start over. I thought it was safe to share my password with my best friend. Now I know you can't. I wish I could disappear.
This address right here, netsmarts.org. If you have something, write it down. Feel free to snap a photo of that or anything else. And while you're doing that, I'll tell you why. Netsmarts.org is a website that everybody should go to. Why? Because it is sponsored by the National Center for Missing and Exploited Children, and it is a great resource to learn about technology, to learn about online safety, to learn about cyberbullying, to learn about sexting, how it occurs, what the definitions are, and a lot of the videos that you see on here and others are there. That is a great resource for parents or for adults who are may not be as confident to talk about technology with their kids, that might just say, you don't even know what I'm talking about. You don't know what an IP address is. You don't know how this application works or anything else. So this is a great place to sit down and watch some of those videos together, and it gives you a common ground to be able to talk about some of these topics, to get over the hill, if you will, to be able to have common ground and build rapport and be able to start that relationship on talking about safe online content. So what can you do? You can establish rules about what to share. Help them set privacy settings. There are a ton of privacy settings out there. Every application has them. Every device has them. I understand. They all change and they might be confusing at times. Best thing to do is look on netsmarts.org. It will may help you out. If not, there will be a help section within the apps. And worst case scenario, open up your browser. Go to Google, go to Bing, go to Safari and type in the app or type in what you're trying to do, and it will give you what you need for as far as the privacy settings on how to set those up. And talk about friends list. Inappropriate information can be everything from pranks, threats, offensive language, drug use. You're going to come across this. It might be shared. But what we don't want to do is share some of those fighting videos that we see. We don't want to promote this illegal behavior. Here's a video about consequences about Eduardo.
Hey, I'm Eduardo. I'm a junior at NHS. I'm not anything special, pretty normal. I get good grades, and my friends are pretty cool.
What's up, Eddie?
And even my parents aren't too bad.
We love you, mijo.
I also do a little swimming. Actually, some recruiters have been checking me out. I'm hoping to get a scholarship for college, so my parents don't have to worry too much about tuition. Last week was a championship meet, and it was awesome. Our team owned it. And I set a school record in freestyle. Someone from the team decided to throw a party, and it was crazy. Everyone from school was there, including the hot girl from my science class.
Hey, Eddie.
People were acting so crazy, I had to take them pictures, man. I may have had a little too much fun. It probably wasn't the smartest thing to take pictures, but then I got really dumb and posted them on my page. It's just what everyone does. And I didn't even think to use my privacy settings. So once I posted them, everyone could see them and anyone could share them. I found that out when I was called to the principal's office and saw some of the pictures from my page sitting on her desk. Coach was there too, and he was really disappointed. It seems like one of my so-called friends had sent them the pictures, but which one? It could have been anybody. My ex-girlfriend, who's always mad at me for something. One of my teammates, who seemed kind of jealous. It could have even been some guy I spoke to once in the ninth grade. I guess it doesn't even matter, because I'm the one who put the pictures up there in the first place. Now my principal's saying that I violated the student-athlete code of conduct. I signed it at the beginning of the year, and it's zero tolerance. Meaning, no more chances. I'm off the team. Goodbye scholarship. On top of that, I got suspended. I've never seen my parents so mad. Even my teammates won't talk to me. Some of them were in those pictures, and they've been called into the principal's office too. At first, I was really mad at whoever sent the pictures. What business was it of theirs? But then, I realized that as soon as I posted the pictures online, I made it their business. It was really all me. I was two kinds of stupid. I was the one who broke the rules. And then I posted the pictures online. It was one mistake after another. So that's my story. I used to be this kid. And now I'm this kid. And this was all it took.
So one of the things that we do when we go out to the schools is we talk about consequences of action. And I challenge the students to say the decisions that you make today can affect your future, just like Eduardo. I ask the students normally, who wants to have a great job? Who wants to go to college? Almost every hand goes up, even some of the younger hands in the audience tonight. Absolutely, that's what we all want. Who wants to have a job that is in public safety or in the military? All of these are things that everybody aspires to. Well, what people don't realize is college and universities now are asking for your not only your grades and your transcripts and your test scores, but also, do you have a social media account? And you have to provide it. Corporations on your job applications are asking what your social media accounts are. Why? Because more and more there is a correlation or an association that when you're accepted into a university or into a corporation, you represent that brand. If you do something that is off the course or unpopular and it shows up in the news, it doesn't just say John Smith did X, Y, and Z. It says John Smith from such and such university or from such and such corporation did this. So you're representing them even when you're not in the classroom or you're not at your desk or in your office. As far as public safety, military, background investigations, More and more public safety requires clearances, and that means background investigations. For the military, in some cases, to get a top secret clearance, they go back 10 years. So do the math. If somebody joins the military and they're in an occupation that deals with intelligence, and they're 17 years old, how far are they going back? Or 18 years old, how far are they going back? To elementary school? I was an officer in the Marine Corps. I was involved in aviation early on in my career. I switched communities and I went to the intelligence world. They didn't care that I had been trusted in the aviation community. I was 28 years old at that time when I made the switch into the intelligence community, and they did my background investigation, went back and spoke to my first grade teacher. So that just goes to show you, luckily I was a good student. You know, luckily, you know, but that being said, you know, today people are under more and more scrutiny, and our presence online is captured and it doesn't go away. A text that you send now might cost you an opportunity next year or 10 years from now. A picture that you post does not go away. I'll share a story with you from one of my colleagues that came across it. There was a 16-year-old. She sent a nude pic to her then boyfriend. He, and you're going to see it in a video later, not about this, but something similar, he passed it on. So she reports it, and the police get involved, the school gets involved, and they think that the issue is resolved. 15 years goes by. So now she's in her mid-30s, and she's successful. She's gone to college. She's become an RN. She's become a nurse practitioner. She is at work at a hospital, at a major hospital. One of her colleagues comes up to her and says, "Hey, is this you?" And she says, "Oh my gosh, I haven't seen that picture in 15 years. I need you to delete it right now." He said, "I would, but it won't do any good. It's all around the hospital. Administration has it, the doctors have it, the nurses have it." Everything she had worked for came full circle because of a decision that she had made 15 years earlier. And think about what that did for her. She had to change locations in the country and try to start over and try to redeem her reputation and some of her professional career because of that. I don't share that story to embarrass her as much as I do say, once an image is on the internet, it never goes away. We can do a lot of things even on law enforcement to try to help mitigate that. We can work with the companies, we can work with NetMec, we can work with other entities, but we cannot control, nor can you, who has access to that image, even if it's deleted. If you post something, a picture, a message, or anything else, and it's up for 5 seconds or 5 minutes, can you control who saw it during that time? If you think wiser and you go back and you delete it five minutes later, and somebody saw it and they screen capture it and then repost it behind you, do you know it's out there? But can it still affect you? Absolutely. So be careful with what you're posting out there, and that's what we pass to the students. You can establish expectations about online behavior, set consequences for inappropriate posts, review comments and pictures, and talk about what their friends are posting as well.
Thank you.
This talks about an epidemic that is involved in every school district across America is affected by it somehow, some way. It doesn't matter how rich or how impoverished that school district is. It doesn't matter whether it is religious or cultural or anything else. Every school district across America has had some interaction with sexting. It is one of the fastest growing epidemics across the country. Why are people doing it? We'll talk about it in a second. You've heard me share one story, and you've seen how it can happen easily in a relationship between teenagers. What you also saw was another the backside of that epidemic, and that's the revenge side. Not only are some of these images being shared and these videos being sent, but when things don't work out in that perfect teenage relationship, then they are used to the detriment and are used as revenge. Why are they doing it? Sometimes it's to be funny. Sometimes it's to impress a crush. But what we see most of all is to share between a boyfriend and girlfriend. And I know in the room, every single teenage love relationship that we had worked out perfect, right? No breakups, everyone's happy. No, of course not. That's what happens. That's what makes the world go round. Everybody has experienced a broken heart at one point or the other. But it's one thing to have a broken heart. It's another thing to be in that situation, have shared something personal, and have that sent as a revenge. Remember how I said you can be anybody that you want on the internet? In this video, pay attention to the profile picture. You can see it up there at the top. But this is what can happen.
Hey, Zach. It's me. I can't stop thinking about you. I know you've been waiting for this for a while. I wanted to give you something special.
See the profile picture at the top? That's who it really is. All of the folders involved. That's not the only person that's been targeted. So what are the consequences? Humiliation, bullying, blackmail, school discipline, and ultimately police involvement. What can you do? You can talk about the consequences ahead of time. And you can talk about how this may seem like a great idea right now, but how can this go bad? What are the ramifications that can come of this? You can tell them never to forward an image if they receive it. If they are in a circle that somebody texts it because it's in a group at a school or a team or anything else, do not forward that image immediately. Tell a trusted adult. And that's where the parents come involved. Tell a coach. Tell an administrator, a counselor, a principal. Somebody needs to know that that is going on and to get law enforcement involved sooner rather than later. You can talk about ways the image can spread online, but most importantly, it needs to be reported. Cyberbullying. Bullying and technology coming together is how we have cyberbullying. Now, for most of us in the room, at least the adults, if I say bully, you're probably going to think back to a cliche in movies or something we saw, you know, growing up, where a bully was somebody that you encountered in the hallway and maybe took your lunch money, maybe stuffed you in a locker or put you in a trash can or something like that. But you really only had to avoid that hallway, you know, or, you know, maybe have a few extra dollars on you to pay them off and they'll leave you alone. And that was your idea of bullying. Cyberbullying is different. Cyberbullying today, you cannot get away from it. You cannot avoid it. Usually a bullying situation that we experienced was one person, or maybe them and their sidekick. That was it. Cyberbullying is the entire world, and they have access to you 24 hours a day from around the world.
Cyberbullied? Have you ever witnessed cyberbullying? 100% of teenagers answer yes to at least one of those questions. So that means everybody has a part to play to help stop this needless behavior online. Play your part by using stop, block, tell. Stop. Stop and think before posting something online that might be upsetting to someone. Think about how you would feel if you were in their position. Block. If you are a victim of cyberbullying, block and report the person that has been bullying you. Tell. If you think you're being cyberbullied, report the person that's bullying you to a parent, guardian, or teacher. Cyberbullying is not okay. Nobody deserves it, and we can all help to put an end to it. For good.
You know, the thing about that video, it brings out the physical aspects that anybody would recognize. But with cyberbullying, you have the internal damage that it is doing that you may not recognize. You may think that's a harmless comment, that it's meant funny, but do you know how the other person on the other end of that conversation is taking that comment? The problem with cyberbullying is anybody can take that first comment and roll it off of their back. And probably have thick skin. That's probably the advice that would be given. Just have thick skin. Don't let it bother you. But can you, what about the 10th comment? The 100th? The 1,000th? The 100,000th 6 months later? Because remember, with cyberbullying, somebody halfway around the world can be involved in the conversation. They don't know you, know the context, and they can just throw a comment out there. And one of the things that I tell students, and I even share with staff and teachers and parents, everybody has something in their life that is a trigger. That if somebody talked about that, it may be a circumstance, it may be a condition, it may be a family member, it may be something. But if somebody mentioned that, it would hurt. It would affect you. And you don't know what that is. And it's different for everybody. So that being said, you never know how cyberbullying can really affect someone and how it can feel like the weight of the world is on you. We're going to talk about that in a second. But examples may be sending mean text or messages, photoshopping pictures as we've already seen in a previous video, spreading rumors or gossip, posting embarrassing photos, or sending threatening or harassing comments. The differences between cyberbullying and bullying spreads faster. Now, Bullying may happen during a certain time frame of opportunity, like we said, walking down that hall. Can you be cyberbullied sitting here right now tonight? Absolutely. How many comments do you think could be posted between the time that you get up from your seats and the time it takes to drive home? And then you look at your phone, your device, your tablet, and all of these people have chimed in, and you didn't do anything. You know, a comment may have been made, and you had no control over it. That's the problem with cyberbullying. Does anybody recognize any of these names or these people? The reason I say that is, unfortunately, these people, Amanda Todd is one of the more well-known ones. All of these people are victims of cyberbullying to the point that they felt that they had no other choice but to take their own life. It has culminated to that. I wish I could say that it was just this slide. Unfortunately, these represent many, many who have felt the pressure of cyberbullying and thought that they had nowhere else to turn to as well. So what came out of that? David's Law. David's Law was signed into law by Governor Abbott. As David was another person who felt that they had no other choice and were cyberbullied to the point that they harmed themselves. So David's Law, instituted in 2017, gives those that are cyberbullied a little bit more protection in the fact that it's easier to get an injunction against people that are cyberbullying you and tell them to stop. It has to be reported to the schools, and the schools have to report it to law enforcement now. With the criminal code, if you cyberbully someone, that might result in a criminal conviction as well. Even a simple comment might arise to the point that when it's investigated, that you may get charged criminally because of that comment. So there is a degree of protection that comes out of that. Cyberbullying is broken down like this. You have the cyberbully, you have the victim, and you have bystanders. All of us are usually bystanders if we're not the other two. Being a bystander, you may be aware of it. You may see somebody who is down because they are being cyberbullied. Be aware of it. They don't have to be your friend. I'm not telling anybody that you have to be friends with everybody in this world. What I am telling you is, can you be nice to them? Can you be a good person? And even if that's not your best friend or even one of your friends, if you see that they are being cyberbullied or experiencing it, can you be a good person and maybe report it? Absolutely. What to do? Save the evidence. You can block the cyberbully, set up a new account, talk to the school, and most importantly, report it. Cyberbullying might stop. They may stop using their computer. They may act nervous, seem uneasy about going to school, or withdraw from the family. They may quickly switch screens when you come around. They may, you know, use the computer odd hours or get upset when they can't have access to not only the computer but the device. They may avoid discussions about what they're doing, and they may use multiple accounts. This is where it would be helpful if you had access to all of the accounts so you could see what was going on. Talk to them about being a bystander and encourage them to report it if they do come across this. There are tech options out there as far as filters, and you know, you can consult your cell phone provider, and they will sit down with you and talk to you about some of those filters and options as well. Here's the problem. Here's the apps that are out right now. When you get used to what those apps can do and everything else, in about 180 days, they change all over again because apps are constantly being developed for the good. They are a tool, and just like any tool, they can be used for good or they can be used for evil as well. Here's a quick video talking about that. Thank you.
It's impossible to believe that your son could get in trouble because somebody forwarded a video to his phone that he has no control over receiving it.
Good kids are the ones it's happening to. Jesse was a great kid, and we have hope. Good kids, and they're the ones who are committing suicide when a picture like this gets out.
There's the other list of apps. So just when you think that you've understand those from the first screen, here's other apps that are not as popular, but kids are using all the time.
Police say it's a problem. Parents have called it dangerous. And new tonight, a West Michigan sex offender is speaking out about the app called Kick. He says it's a perfect setup for offenders to find their victims.
After seeing our Target 8 investigation, a man who calls himself a recovering sexual predator contacted us about his interactions on the app, and he showed us just how easy he could get in touch with children.
Parents need to see this, and 24-Hour News 8's Leon Hendricks has our investigation.
That's why I wanted to tell my story.
Speaking in the shadows to protect his privacy, this man makes no secret of who he is.
I will always be a sex offender. I will always be a sexual predator.
Now in his mid-30s, it was in the late 90s when he was convicted of sexually abusing a child under 13. He served prison time and is listed on the sex offender registry, and the challenge to stay clean continues.
It's always going to be a lifetime struggle.
He found the Kick app far before Target 8 profiled the risk it exposes Sunday night.
The first thing that I thought was, wow, I can be whoever I want to be. I can get anybody I want. I can achieve my sexual glorification through this app. That's when I said, you know what, I have to stop this.
He deleted the app, but he wanted to show us just how easy it is for someone like him to find potential victims on the app. On one of our phones, he used one of the apps inside of the Kick app and showed us just how easy it was to become someone else. A quick Google search to find a picture, and we had the profile of a 15-year-old boy with a personal description he says is perfect.
I'm sad. That's all I'm going to write.
He set the parameters for who he was looking to speak with, and within minutes, without reaching out to anyone, we had two apparent teenage girls reaching out to us.
Why are you sad? And right there is where you got the open door.
One of the girls had a screen name, suggesting she was having personal struggles.
That's when a sexual predator can jump in. Like me, I would jump in and say, hey, what's your problem? Let's talk.
We did not respond and deleted the profile. But this, he hopes, drives the message home.
Please make sure to take Kick off your kid's phone.
Technology is a great tool. It can't catch everything. The only way that that can happen is to communicate. To communicate with your children, communicate with those in the community that can help if you need resources, and to have really outreach programs like this where you have the knowledge, where you understand kind of what is going on a little bit more. That is the iGuardian presentation. Thank you very much for allowing us to come tonight and to present to you, to pass this information. Did everybody learn something tonight in some form or fashion? Thank you so much for having us and hosting us. And are there any questions before we move on? Anything? Yes, sir. There,
every day,
just keep coming, right?
Yes. I mean, we could provide the list, but, you know, honestly, if you open up, Apple or Google or anything else, they're all on there. They're all constantly being used. And even Kick, what we see commonly is an app like Kik has been around for years. People will stop using it and go to another messaging system or anything else. And then a few years later, everybody's back on Kik. You know, at the beginning I was talking about Facebook, you know, and how it's now moved to maybe an older generation, and I fall into that category. But every so often, it gets a rebound, and it becomes the most popular thing, and everybody's back on Facebook, and you know, and then it falls out of favor. So these apps are constantly being developed. There is constantly something new out there, and it may look the same, but it has different features. It may take the features of two, put them together, and create another app 6 months from now. So it's not that I have reservation about sharing the apps or the app list, but they are all in the Apple and Google stores. Even if you just